I will try to explain hypothesis testing in a way that even high school student can understand it easily. Let's say there is a pharma company called Atlic Pharmaceutical, and they have a drug A, which is a very popular drug for treating headache. So if you have a headache, if you take drug A, you know, it cures it within few hours, and it is being used by millions of people, very popular drug. Now the scientist in this company invents a new drug called drug B, and they claim that drug B takes less time to cure headache compared to A. So their claim is that total number of hours that are needed to cure headache are less if you take drug B versus drug A. Now how do you prove that? You can't roll out that drug B and give it to millions of people, right? You need to first test it, do a clinical trial. How about you get 10 volunteers and 10 volunteers who are having headache, and give drug A to 5 volunteers and drug B to remaining 5, and kind of measure a time. Let's say drug A takes 4 hours to get rid of headache, drug B takes only 3 hours to get rid of headache. Did we prove that drug B is effective than A? Well, obviously answer is no, because our sample size is very small. In statistics, since you can't test certain things on the entire population, we take a sample, and here our sample was 10 volunteers. And 10 volunteers versus millions of people is definitely a very small sample. So we can say that maybe this happened because of a random chance, or the sample is not good enough to give you confidence that B is more effective than A. Then what do you do? Well, you increase the sample size. Let's say you take 1,000 volunteers, maybe 500 are taking drug A, 500 are taking drug B. Again, drug B takes average 3 hours, the drug A takes average 4 hours to get rid of headache completely. Have we proven that B is effective, and are we in a position to roll it out to millions of people? Well, maybe not sure, because 1,000 versus millions of people, maybe 1,000 still is not a big enough size. Other problem is, what if the 500 people on whom you tested B are all young folks, you know, with better immunity, and remaining 500 people on whom you use drug A, they are old folks or they have underlying condition, their immunity is a little weak, you know? So it depends on the two factors. One is the sample size, and how much variation you have in that sample. Do you have people from all age groups, different medical condition, different ethnicity? You need to consider a lot of factor in order to conduct an effective test. Now let me give you another example of coin flipping. So what I did once is, I had this coin, I flipped it 7 times, and usually you expect that you will get head and tail, you know, equal number of times. What happened for me is, in first 4 times I got head. And I started thinking, maybe there is something wrong with this coin. Maybe it's counterfeit. Maybe it is favoring head. So you can try this experiment. Try flipping this coin so many times. And many times you will find that, you know, 4 times, 5 times, even 6, 7 times in a sequence, you might get head or tail. And you will think there is something wrong with the coin. But the reality is that nature tricks you. Nature tricks you in a way that you will start thinking that there is an underlying reason behind an event or a phenomena, whereas the fact is that it is pure randomness. This is the natural law. I'm from India. I've seen enough examples of successful astrologists who try to predict your future, who will, you know, there was one astrologist who used to say that, okay, at age 35 you will have unexpected monetary benefit. Maybe you will win a lottery, or you will get a bonus or something. Now if you make that claim to 100 people, maybe 20 or 30 people you will get it right, and that's just because of pure randomness. But then people think that, no, this astrologer knows how to see the future. So they think of randomness, you know, actually the underlying cause is randomness, But the way the events are happening in nature, it makes you think that there is an underlying reason. And the purpose of hypothesis testing is to get rid of this element of randomness. Basically, it is to figure out that observed result is not because of a random chance and there is a strong reason behind it. So in our case, drug B is more effective than A, and in our test that we are performing, hypothesis testing allows you to rule out the element of a randomness. So if you do hypothesis testing, you can scientifically prove that drug B is more effective than A. And how exactly hypothesis testing is conducted is beyond the scope of this video, but I will talk about some of the methods. Now, in our case, drug B being more effective than drug A is called alternate hypothesis. An alternative hypothesis is, you know, represented using HA. So HA means the claim you want to prove. And we always come up with the opposite hypothesis, which is also called a null hypothesis, which is drug B is not more effective than drug A. So drug B not being more effective than drug A is null hypothesis, and null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis, they are exactly opposite. Now, why do we need null hypothesis? Why can't we directly prove that drug B is more effective than drug A? Well, null hypothesis, first of all, represents the established fact. What is the established fact? Well, drug A is the most effective drug by Atlik Pharmaceutical in the market. So drug A is being used by millions of people since past 5 years, and it is the established fact. And if someone is coming up with drug B and saying that, okay, drug B is more effective, we want to play devil's advocate. We want to look at that claim with a lot of skepticism and start our inquiry by saying that no, drug B is not more effective than drug A. Drug A has been very effective since past 5 years. So many people have used it. So I don't believe drug B is more effective than A. So we want to start with the established fact, you know, whatever is true as of now. And then we do a couple of tests, you know, using hypothesis testing, and try to prove that my null hypothesis is wrong. Or we try to reject the null hypothesis, basically. We try to reject that drug B is not more effective than A. When you reject that, you automatically prove that drug B is actually effective than drug A. It is like going to a courtroom, you know, someone committed a murder, but we always say innocent until proven guilty. So in the court, we'll always start with us by saying that, okay, this person is innocent, they have not committed a murder. And then the lawyers on the opposite end will try to reject that statement. So null hypothesis is the person is not guilty, and the lawyers on the opposite side will try to prove that this statement that the person is not guilty is wrong. And by doing that, they prove that the person is guilty. There are many examples of null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis, and I'll go through some of them. Back in time, people used to believe that the sun rotates around the earth. So people back in days used to believe earth is static at the place, sun rotates around it. Then Copernicus came in with a theory that no, that is not true. So the null hypothesis at that time was sun rotates around the earth. It was a widely accepted belief for many years, and then someone comes and says that no, this is not true, that sun rotates around the earth. And when you reject that claim, automatically the second most claim that is there becomes kind of an established truth. So the way it works is, the claim that you're trying to prove, you cannot say for sure that this is the truth. So whatever is the opposite, you try to reject it, and then this second most established thing kind of becomes the truth. It's like, you know, at some point Roger Federer was number one player, number one tennis player. So the null hypothesis is Roger Federer is the best tennis player. Then Djokovic came in, and now you want to say Djokovic is better player than Federer. But instead of proving that, what if you prove that Federer is not the best player, or he's not the number one player? And when you do that, automatically number two, who is Djokovic, becomes number one. And you don't want to say that, okay, Djokovic is the best player because tomorrow someone else might come in. So that the statement that Djokovic is the best player, it's hard to prove, you know. It's not an absolute fact. Things are always changing. So someone can come in and say, okay, some new player will come and they can become a best player. So that's the whole idea behind having null hypothesis. So in hypothesis testing, you have a claim that you want to prove, that is called alternate hypothesis. You go with the alternate claim, which is an established fact or widely accepted phenomena, and you try to reject that. Another example is, you know, up till now, before pandemic, the belief was employees are more productive in office. Now that's how the world has been, and everyone knows that, and you know, that's my null hypothesis. And some HR people are coming up with a theory that employees can be productive at home also. So basically the opposite. It's not like employees have to be in office in order to become more productive. Now that's a new thing. You know, that's a new thing. We have not experienced it much. Maybe 1.5 years into pandemic, now we know a little bit, but people working from office has been like that since thousands of years. So that's my null hypothesis. And my new hypothesis, alternate hypothesis, is employee can be more productive working from home as well. Third example I want to give is irritable bowel disease has no relationship with food that you eat. That's an accepted belief right now in medical science. And some new scientist comes up with a theory that no, by eating certain food, it can cause irritable bowel disease. So then the null hypothesis, which is irritable bowel disease has no relation with food, you can reject that. And if you reject that, you kind of establish the fact that these two have a relationship. Let's say you are a data scientist working in Amazon. You have built this recommendation engine, you know, which shows you product recommendation, and there is a machine learning model behind it. And that machine learning model is, let's say, A. Okay, so and Amazon has been using this model for maybe 2 years, you know, 3 years. So many people are using it. So null hypothesis is, so basically the model A is something that is established fact, that is something being used by so many people. And now a data scientist working at Amazon comes up with a new model, model B, and they claim that model B is better than model A. They provide better product recommendation. So in order to prove that, you have to come up with null hypothesis, which will be B is not better than A, and you try to reject it. When you reject it, you automatically prove that B is better than A. So now the question is, how do you exactly conduct hypothesis testing? There are many techniques: Z-test, T-test, ANOVA, chi-square or chi-square test. So there are so many techniques that allows you to eliminate the factor of randomness from the claim that you're testing. Okay, so that's what hypothesis testing is all about. I hope this video gave you some idea. If you have any question, post in a video comment below. I have the entire series of math and statistics for data science. Knowing these concepts are going to be super useful if you are pursuing a data science career journey. If you have any questions, again, post in a comment below. Thank you.